Let's work three examples related to three-phase transformers here. In North America, residential single-phased neutral is 120 volts RMS. We'll assume that the primary connection is Y, and in this problem, let's arrange the transformers so that three such phases, each at 120 volts, are distributed to the customer. Usually on the secondary side, the top wire will be neutral. We've been told in the problem that the primary connection is Y, so let's go ahead and draw those connections in for the primary side. One phase will connect to the bushing on one transformer, one phase will connect to primary bushing on another transformer, and likewise for the third transformer. Our secondaries will be connected to the star point and the neutral wire. If we look over here at our diagram for the transformer, we can see that we have 240 volts across the secondaries of this transformer, and we have 120 volts RMS between the center tap and either of the other two secondaries. Let's make the high voltage side of our Y connection first. We now have our three phases distributed to these lines, but which secondary are we going to use? Well, the wrong way to do it would be to connect these three secondaries to our neutral. If we were to do that, then we would have 240 volts RMS from all of the three phases to neutral. What we should instead do is connect the center tap to neutral. We'll let that third connection float because we don't need it. If I were to take a voltmeter and now measure the voltage difference in RMS between any of these three phases to neutral, I would get 120 volts RMS. On the other hand, if I were to measure the voltage between any of the three phases, then I would measure 208 volts RMS. That's 120 times the square root of 3. Now, I've not drawn the grounding connections on this pole, but normally the neutral would be grounded at the pole. Let's take a look here at a delta secondary, and in particular, we're going to look at something called a wild leg delta connection. This is common in rural installations in North America. If the voltages between each leg are all 240 volts, we're going to calculate the voltages from each leg to neutral. Let's go ahead and label all of our voltages. These are all in RMS. If I were to use a voltmeter and measure these voltages, this is what I would read. I hope you can appreciate here that it's possible to create such a wild leg delta configuration using transformers like this that have a center tap. In this diagram, the center tap becomes the neutral wire, and I've colored it white to match the typical color code used in North America. One of our phases is colored black, another phase is colored blue, and then our high leg, or the wild leg, is colored orange, and that's by convention. In the problem, we're told to calculate the voltages from each leg to neutral. Some of them are easy. For example, the voltage from leg 1 to neutral is just 120 volts RMS. We've already written that on our circuit. Likewise, the voltage from leg 2 to neutral is also 120 volts. However, we can't just subtract in order to get the voltage from the high leg to neutral because the 240 volts across this leg is out of phase with the 120 volts across that leg. We're going to have to use phasors in order to find the RMS voltage here. We can define our neutral point as 0 volts, and if we want to then calculate the voltage between the high leg and neutral, we can use KVL. It's the voltage from 2 to neutral added to the voltage from phase H to phase 2. Now, we can't add them in RMS values. We're going to have to convert them to phasors in order to handle the fact that these voltages are out of phase with one another. Relative to our neutral point, leg 2 is 120 volts at an angle of 0 degrees. And we know that our high leg is 120 degrees out of phase with the voltage at leg 2. Remember that in a three-phase system, all of the phases are out of phase with one another by 120 degrees. It's always going to be that way. We can now convert from polar to rectangular. This is just 120, and this number is minus 120 plus 207.8 J. We can see that our voltage from high to neutral is nearly 208 J volts. So the magnitude of that voltage, or rather the RMS value, is just 208 volts. The advantage of this kind of wild leg delta in a rural installation is that you can still service single phase loads because you have 120 degrees from either leg 1 to neutral or leg 2 to neutral. And furthermore, you can service three-phase loads at 240 volts between the phases. There's one more advantage of delta connect transformers that I want to discuss here in example 3, and that is the following. in a Y-connected transformer, if one of the three coils were to fail, or one of the three transformers in the bank were to fail, then that phase would go offline. However, with a delta-connected transformer, it still works if one of the three transformers in the bank fails. That's what we're going to look at here in this particular example. Let's assume that the transformer here between phases A and C fails and becomes open. Let's then calculate what fraction of the original maximum power can still be delivered to the load. First, let's consider the amount of current that has to pass through all these coils before the failure takes place. When we're talking about the maximum power that can be delivered to the load, we're actually asking a question about the maximum possible current that any of these particular transformers can handle. See, that maximum current that the transformer can handle is not going to change in either the case of having a failure or not having a failure. Let's label some voltages here. We'll call this voltage V out at an angle of 0 degrees. We'll call the voltage over here the same thing at an angle of minus 120 degrees. And we'll call the voltage over here the same thing at an angle of plus 120 degrees. Let's now label the currents passing through each one of these transformers. We'll call it the phase current. So this is the phase current between A and B. This is the phase current between C and A. And this is the phase current between B and C. Let's use Ohm's law to find these phase currents. And let's start with CA. So we have the voltage drop divided by the resistance. We'll assume it's connected to a given load, but we won't specify what that load actually is. Let's go ahead and convert polar to rectangular, combine the numbers together, and then convert back to polar form. Let's now consider the current flowing through this secondary coil, the transformer. We have a particular voltage drop divided by R. We can write those numbers explicitly in polar form. We can then convert them into rectangular form, combine them together, and then convert them to polar form. At this point, we have expressions for two of the currents in the coils of the transformer. I'm going to define the current here coming out through this particular line as I sub L, the line current. I'm also going to assume that we have the same resistive loads connected between all of the phases. What ultimately determines the amount of power delivered to the load is the current here, I sub L, that's passing out through this phase. If we have a balanced load, then the currents through phase B and phase C should be the same. Applying the Kirchhoff current law at the node of phase A, we know that the line current is the difference of these two phase currents. We can substitute in from what we found before. And if we convert from polar to rectangular, then we quickly find that the imaginary parts cancel and we wind up with just 3. Let's now consider what happens after the failure. If one transformer out of the bank of 3 fails, one of the advantages of the delta configuration is that the voltages are still there. You can get by with just 2 out of the 3 transformers. However, the currents are going to change just a little bit. The phase current between A and B is going to be just what it was before because the voltage between phase A and phase B is exactly what it was before the failure. This current is going to be 0 because it's not flowing at all, and that's going to cause the line current to change. If I again apply the Kirchhoff current law at node A, I have that the line current is now just negative the phase current AB. The magnitude of the line current before the failure was 3 V out over R, and the magnitude of the line current after the failure was 1.73 V out over R. Less current is flowing after the failure, which means that the maximum power that you can draw at your load is going to be reduced accordingly. This transformer can deliver 57.7% of the original current to the load. So we could say that the transformer is operating at 57.7% efficiency if one of the 3 transformers here in the bank were to fail. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.